Praise the Lord. What a day to be alive to give God thanks. We're having a great time in the Word of God on the subject of why remembrance. I'm giving you a clear, undisputable reason why you should live a life remembering what God has done for you. It's a lifesaver. It's a lifesaver. You owe it to yourself and your family and everyone who knows you're a Christian to understand the principles that govern our walk with God. And that's why the Holy Spirit has laid on my heart to teach the subject, why remembrance? Why you must remember? You owe it to yourself and your walk with God. Let us pray. Father, we have reason to thank you for all the things you've done for us in days gone by. You have given us a promise that you bring us to a wealthy place. And therefore, this morning, I thank you that even as I declare your word, let power, let great grace be upon my lips for the edification of my hearers. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's hit the ground running, looking first of all to the scriptures. Psalm 6, verse 5. For in death, there is no remembrance of you. And if we can believe anyone, let's believe David. If that's what David said, the chances are that he wanted us to understand that remembrance is when we are alive. For in death, there is no remembrance of you, of God. So let's do it now whilst we can. But then, have you taken time to look around and see the things for which you should give God thanks? Or you take anything for granted with a sense of entitlement? It is mine. I'm entitled to it. I went to the school myself. I paid my own fees. I did my own press-ups. And I had my six-packs. I protected myself because I have a good car. Oh no, come off your high horse. Easier said than that. There are too many things in life that are directly under the thumb of the Lord. He said, in death there is no remembrance of you. And in the grave, who will give you thanks? I ended up the last time with a story that is worth repeating. Some stories should be told twice. And I said I read from the News of the World, UK, that since the UK lottery was launched in 1994, it has created more than 2,400 millionaires. And it has paid out then over 36 billion pounds. There is a weird, weird, funny twist to one of the stories I read that helps to establish the message I'm teaching. Hospital porter. Well, for the lack of a better word, we can call him mortuary man. Maybe he isn't directly that. But was a hospital porter, 44 years old, and his name I read was John McGuinness. He won £10 million in 1997 in the lottery. Watch it. 11 years after, in 2008, all the money was gone. Why? You may be shouting that, it cannot ever happen to me. If I get that money, I'll do this, I'll do that, I'll do this. Not so fast. He invested in a third division Scottish football club when he didn't know anything about football. Before the lottery, he used to earn £150 a week and slept in the parents' hall. The father and mother jumped over him, hop, step, and jump to go to the master bedroom. He gave £3 million. Winning to all family members. The millionaire has come to town. £750,000 he gave to his old wife, ex-wife Hazel. Called her and said, old wifey, this is money. Take £750,000. He bought a Ferrari. This guy had only a bicycle that he rode to work. He bought a Ferrari, Mercedes-Benz, a Bentley, a Jaguar, a BMW. He took a holiday to Mallorca, to the Caribbeans. He gave £1 million to his in-laws. £200,000 had a great wedding that shook the town. After years of wastage, he blew the money. He owed the Royal Bank of Scotland £2.1 million. Later we read in the story, his wife Sandra, a former nurse, had enrolled in a hair dressing saloon. Back to square one. Can someone tell me, listening? You may be shouting, God forbid, it can never happen to me. As for me, I have the blueprint. Not so fast. Let me read you another one. Michael Carroll was a garbage man in England at the age of 19 when he won £9.7 million. In a lottery in the year 2000, a huge mansion, drugs, call girls, gold jewelry, big money blown around. 10 years after, he was broke. Why does it happen so often? Let us look at the word of God. Go with me to Deuteronomy chapter 8. Deuteronomy, please. Let's check out what God says about this. Deuteronomy chapter 8. 430 years. Let's give the backdrop to the reading of Deuteronomy chapter 8. 430 years in captivity and in slavery in Egypt. They were now about to go to the promised land. So we'll call this the marching orders. They were about to move. And Moses had so many things to talk about. This was the speech he made. And in my study, I found out that Moses used two words. Do not forget, remember, do not forget, remember. In the Hebrew, the word remembrance occurs 250 times. Bible scholars have found that. Remembrance is a human challenge. Capacity to remember. So, in Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 2, listen to what Moses said to the children of Israel. And you shall remember that the Lord your God led you all the way to humble you. First one, remember. Remember that it is God who leads you. Verse 11, it goes on to say in verse, beware that you do not forget. The opposite of remember is do not forget. And Moses told the children of Israel. Later in our study, we are going to find out how they blew it big time. They did not take the advice of Moses. And then we can do a comparative analysis and contemporary reference. How far are you away from them? Are you like them? You can swear that it can never happen to you. Not so fast. Deuteronomy 8, 2, remember. Deuteronomy 8, verse 11, do not forget. Remember Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 14. That's what it says. And when your heart is lifted up, and you forget the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt. It is not hard to make promises when you are broke. When you are lying on your back. When you are in a 12 by 12 room. And all the children are there. And you must jump over the cooking pot. Across 6 children to go out. It is not hard. But when you have the stars in your eyes. And you have money. And money is coming. And everything is playing out. It's a different ball game. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 2, do not forget. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 11, remember. Verse 14, it says, do not forget. Verse 18, it says in verse 18, you shall remember. Verse 19, do not forget. So we find two words, remember, do not forget, remember, do not forget. It's crucial for you to understand what happened to the children of Israel and how you can escape yourself. Hallelujah. Amen. How you can escape from the tragedy of what happened to the children of Israel. In actual fact, when we fast forward the whole message and move into the future, to Psalm 106, we get a picture of what happened to the children of Israel, whether they took Moses' advice or not. Four things resulted from Psalm 106. We are looking at why you should remember. Go with me, ladies and gentlemen, to Psalm 106. Some messages cannot be preached. It can only be taught. And so let's go speedily to Psalm 106. Thank you. Psalm 106. Psalm 106, this is what the Bible says. In Psalm 106, it says, four things will result if you do not remember. Lessons from the life of the children of Israel. Psalm 106, verse 6. We have sinned with our fathers and have committed iniquity. We have done wickedly. Our fathers in Egypt did not understand your wonders. They did not remember the multitude of your mercies. Number one, not remembering and forgetting God's past benevolence is a sin. Psalm 106, verse 6. Not remembering what God has done for you in the past is a sin. You used to sleep in a single room. Now God has given you a good apartment. You used to be alone. You prayed, fasted, and God gave you a husband. What has been your response mechanism? You worked many years, graduate unemployment on a massive and mammoth scale, and God singled you out and gave you a job. Look at all the things God has done for you. 430 years. They did not know how to come out. It was God who delivered them. He said, your cry has ascended unto me, and I am come down to deliver you. Deuteronomy 8, they were warned. Do not forget. Remember. But Psalm 106 gives us a very sad story. Number one, not remembering and forgetting God's past benevolence. Your marriage, your family, your ministry. It was in a small classroom. Today you have become big. You have many members. You can travel anywhere you want. Eat what you want. Wear what you want. It is easy to forget. Number one, not to remember what God has done, his past benevolence, is a sin. Psalm 106, verse 6. We have sinned with our fathers. We have not remembered the multitude of your mercies, but rebelled by the sea, the Red Sea. Number two, not remembering and forgetting God's past benevolence leads to unbelief. But we have not remembered your past, but rebelled by the Red Sea. Number two, note it. Not remembering and forgetting God's past benevolence, child of God, leads to unbelief, rebellion. You live as if God hasn't done anything for you. And you go on with your life. Promises you make, you don't keep. Vows you make, you don't keep. You don't pay your tithe anymore. You don't ask the pastor to do anything in church. You just go on. You prefer to sponsor worldly programs. Programs in your hometown. Programs, there's nothing wrong with it. But give first to God who promoted you. Seek first the kingdom of God. That's what Matthew 6:33 says. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That's what the Bible says. And every other thing shall be added unto you. Sometimes you wonder why God cuts off the blessing. So we have seen in a brief recap, number one, not remembering but forgetting God's past benevolence is a sin. Psalm 106, verse 6. Two, not remembering but forgetting God's past benevolence leads to unbelief and rebellion. You behave like an unbeliever. Number three, not remembering and forgetting God's past benevolence makes you do foolish things. I didn't say that. It's God's word. Psalm 106, verse 13. Let's go look at it. They soon forgot his works. They did not wait for his counsel. Now you are not praying anymore. You don't want to hear from God. Your mind is made up. Verse 15. And he gave them to their request and sent leanness into their soul. Not remembering, but forgetting God's past benevolence makes us do foolish things. Verse 19 of Psalm 106. So, number three from Psalm 106. We are looking at the children of Israel, the caution of Deuteronomy 8, and how it played and panned out years after. The same thing can happen to you. And that's the purpose of this teaching. So number three, not remembering, but forgetting God's past benevolence makes us do foolish things. Psalm 106, 13 to 20. Look at verse 19 of Psalm 106. They made a calf in Horeb and worshipped the molded image. Thus they change their glory into the image of an ox that eats grass. They forgot God, their Savior. I feel like crying. They forgot God, their Savior. These were former slaves. People were going nowhere. And God took them and gave them a promised land. They forgot. So, number three, not remembering and forgetting God's past benevolence can make us do foolish things. Get involved in programs that are irrelevant. Do things in the world rather than support God's agenda. Buy things that are worthless to your life. When you have things to do in church you haven't done. I read somewhere and someone said it's called affluenza. Influenza is a virus in medical terms, sneezing and all the lot. But it said there's rich people suffer from affluenza. Affluenza means from affluence, buying unnecessary things. New bicycle. It's not messed up. You buy another one. The car. It gets a puncture. You buy a newer one. And the old one, which is also hasn't run out, is in the garage. You have many things in the warehouse you don't use. We go into the homes. Many things that others will cry for are spilled over. I mean, just a small thing, a small dent on it. Oh, you park the car somewhere. They suffer from affluenza. And that is the problem. Not remembering and forgetting God's past benevolence makes us do foolish things. Sponsor church leader. God has prospered you. There are bills in church, vows you have made, tithe you have not paid, and you are sponsoring programs for unbelievers so that you can be seen on TV. God is coming. God is coming. And your name is there. Your pastor is looking at it, and God is watching you. Number four, finally. Not remembering, but forgetting God's past benevolence ignites God's anger. God will not take it. That's what? Wait till you hear me in the next teaching. The children of Israel and how God punished them for not remembering what he has done. So number four, not remembering, but forgetting God's past benevolence ignites God's anger. Psalm 106, verse 21. They forgot God, their Savior. These are not my words. This is God's words. They forgot God, their Savior. Can I say to you, is it possible for you to forget where you were born? Even if they expand the map of your country to the whole of your bedroom, your village cannot be traced. And today God has prospered you. It is a dangerous thing, child of God listening to me, whoever. It is a dangerous thing to forget where God took you from. It is a risky business. If you are going to walk with God in peace, take this message a little more seriously. They forgot God, their Savior. They were slaves. The taskmaster was on them, beating them day and night. They could not have any rest. They worked from morning to evening. A slave has no rights. A slave doesn't go on a holiday. A slave doesn't travel first class. A slave doesn't eat good food he wants. Slaves with no future. And God took them and gave them a promised land. You would have thought that they would serve God with all their hearts. Psalm 106. And they forgot God, their Savior. My heart is broken. They forgot God, their Savior. My voice is shaking. They forgot God. Who had done great things in Egypt? See what God has done for you. It's time somebody told you the truth. Who had done great things, wondrous works in the land of Ham. We are pushing. Awesome things at the Red Sea. You nearly died. Sakadobahaya. The doctors gave up on you. They said your case is a hopeless case. Even if they fly you abroad, you are not likely to come back. You come back in the undercarriage. You become a thing. You will not be a human being. And God saved your life. It's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of God. Look at it as we close. Psalm 106, verse 21. Wondrous things in the land of Ham. Verse 23. Therefore he said that he would destroy them. Had not Moses his chosen stood in the breach to turn away his wrath. Number four. Not remembering and forgetting God's past benevolence ignites God's anger. God can be upset with you. We want to close with this today. Very important. Why we must give thanks. Wow. Why we must give thanks. And I want to share it with you as we close. And we'll continue by the grace of God in the next series. Why we must give thanks. Number one, it preserves the blessing. Malachi chapter 3, 1 to 3. The blessing of God released to us is when you appreciate what God has done, God adds to it. The blessing of God is released to us in measure to the appreciation we express. So number one, why we must give God thanks? To preserve what you already have. Malachi chapter 3, 1 to 3. You can write it down and cross-check later. Why we must give thanks, number two. To perfect our blessing. Let's read that. We may not have time, but let's read it. Luke chapter 17, verse 15. Let's check it out. 17, 15. Straightforward case. And the one of them, when he saw he was healed, we'll be teaching on this intensively later, returned and with a loud voice glorified God. You can't give thanks quietly. Oh, Bishop, I was educated in Harvard. I went to Stanford. I'm an Oxford graduate. I'm prim and proper. So I don't like jumping around like a tomboy. Hold it. You cannot give thanks quietly. I've seen people roll on the floor, not showmanship. They are overwhelmed by what God has done. So stop telling me you are prim and proper and polished. You know what God has done for you. The doctors gave up on you. The car was coming directly towards you. It was a life and death issue. And God saved your life. And you are telling me you cannot stand before the church and give God thanks. Wait till God comes to meet you. Number one, why we give God thanks? To preserve the blessing. Malachi 3, 1 to 3. Number two. So number one, to preserve the blessing. Preservation of any blessing is based on the thanksgiving you show. Number two, to perfect our blessing. And we've read Luke chapter 17, verse 15. Even if not for anything at all, to let God know your heart. That you appreciate what he has done. Keeping quiet is not enough. Number three, why do we give God thanks? To keep the anointing fresh. And I believe it. I believe it. Zechariah chapter 4, 6 to 7. Fresh anointing, fresh power. If your father does something for you, and you are not able to appreciate it, how do you expect your father to continue doing for you over and over again? And finally, we wrap up today as I share my mind with you on this. When I see a poor man who is grateful, I know if he were rich, he would be generous. When I see a poor man who is grateful, I know if he were rich, he would be generous. I want you to know today, child of God, that thankfulness is the secret to a happy life. Thankfulness is the secret to a happy Christian life. And I wrap up with this. Thanksgiving purges us. Remembrance, thanksgiving, thankfulness purges us as human beings of our self-conceit and selfishness. Psalm 29, 1 to 2 say, give unto the Lord thanksgiving. By the grace of God. We'll be taking a look. Now we are going to go into the Bible. We are going to transfer all that we have learned so far in the last two series. We are going to take a look at the life of Hannah. The peculiar situation he faced in 1 Samuel chapter 1. How he navigated through the crisis with a life of remembrance and thanksgiving. And then I'm going to move you to Luke chapter 17. And we are going to look at 10 minus 1. 10 minus 1. The one leper who came back. Now, except you have a backdrop of what leprosy really was, then you cannot appreciate what it meant when that man came back. And the nine who took off and went to Guangzhou, and some went to Peking, some went to China, some went to Dubai. I don't really know where the nine went. But next week we'll find out where they went. And you will know. Thanksgiving purges us of self-conceit, selfishness. It makes us appreciate what God has done for you. May you not suffer from spiritual amnesia forgetting what God has done. Psalm 106, we have found out you can pay a very heavy price. May God bless you. Amen. Come on and breathe.
Yesterday's gone. Oh, today I'm in need of fire. Holy Ghost, fire. Holy Ghost, shine.